Hello, and welcome to the TI Precision Lab for channel-to-channel crosstalk in Precision DACs. In this video, we will define AC and DC channel-to-channel crosstalk, discuss some common sources of crosstalk in Precision DAC designs, and review strategies to help minimize the impact of it in your design. First, let's start by defining channel-to-channel crosstalk. In a basic sense, crosstalk is defined as an output change on one channel of a multi-channel DAC affecting another channel. There are two types of this crosstalk, AC and DC. AC crosstalk is where a transient on one channel of a DAC, output 1 in the figure, causes a temporary change in another channel, output 2 in the figure. Here we see as output 1 started to change, output 2 had a small glitch. This is usually measured similarly to glitch energy, where the total charge of the transient on the affected channel is measured. DC crosstalk is where the potential of one channel causes a static change in another channel. This is usually measured in volts as a DC potential. Now let's look at an example of a DAC's channel-to-channel crosstalk specification. Consider the DAC 80504, which is a 16-bit DAC with 4 channels and an optional external reference. This device shares a single reference buffer for all 4 channels. Here we have specified that the AC crosstalk for the device is 2 nanovolt seconds. This is measured on a channel which is at mid-scale output, while the adjacent channel has a nearly a full-scale transition. The DC crosstalk specification is under two different conditions. The first value, 5 microvolts, is the difference measured on a channel that is at mid-scale output after only one of the 3 remaining channels transitions from a zero scale to full-scale output. The second value, 10 microvolts, is the difference measured on a channel after all 3 other channels transition from a zero scale to full-scale output. But where does this glitch come from? Well, there are a few sources: physical routing of the device outputs, power supply loading, and reference loading. First, we will talk about the device layout as being a cause. Consider this example layout. We see that we have 2 DAC outputs, OUT1 and OUT2, that are routed next to each other to an adjacent IC. Ideally, this layout is fine, but if you consider that all physical systems have parasitic resistance and capacitance, we can find a few problems. First, there is stray capacitance between the 2 outputs of these 2 pieces of metal that are routed in parallel. Secondly, these traces will also act as inductors, and when placed next to each other, form a transformer. The capacitive and inductive coupling between the outputs will result in small transients being coupled from one output to another when it changes, causing AC crosstalk. These physical parasitics are found inside the device as well, but that cannot be reduced on a PCB layout level, only during the device's design. The next cause of channel-to-channel crosstalk that we will consider is power supply loading. Consider that most DACs have a dedicated output buffer for each of the outputs, as shown in the figure. These buffers will usually share a single supply pin. Also note that there is usually a small resistance on all traces and package leads, indicated by R-series, as all metals are technically resistors as well. If the load on one of the output changes, like when the DAC code changes, a current, I-out, will need to be sourced by the supply as well. If the previous voltage on VDD was equal to V-supply, it is now equal to V-supply minus I-out times R-series. This means that a change on output 1 has caused the supply for the buffer for output 2 to change as well. That is fine if the buffer for the output 2 is ideal, but it is not. All amplifiers have some power supply rejection behavior, usually quantified as power supply rejection ratio, or PSRR. An amplifier's power supply rejection refers to how little the output changes when the amplifier's supply changes. Generally, the change is very little, but it can still be measured. This can result in both AC and DC channel-to-channel crosstalk on a DAC. And finally, we will get to the greatest contributor to channel-to-channel crosstalk, reference loading. Let's get back to the basic element of a precision DAC, the precision ladder. There are multiple architectures for DACs, but let's start by considering the R2R topology. Recall that R2R architectures have a series of switches that'll toggle the two R legs of the ladder to either ground or the voltage reference. An important thing to remember is that this results in a code-dependent load on the reference. Let's consider when all the switches are in the left position. Here, there is no load on the reference. But when they switch to the right position, the maximum load is placed on the reference. Let's look at what happens to the reference voltage when this load current changes. Consider a DAC with an external reference pin. Similar to the power supply pin we just discussed, all physical components have a series resistance. R series, as shown in the figure, is comprised of the resistance created by the trace, the package lead, and bond wire, as well as any series resistance in the die itself. As we now have a series resistance, what happens to the VREF internal voltage when the load of the R2R ladder changes? When the load increases, the VREF internal value reduces as there is now a voltage drop across R series. This can result in some non-linearity and gain error on a device with a single channel. But what happens in a multi-channel device? Well, on multi-channel devices, this reference loading will result in DC channel-to-channel crosstalk, as the change in load caused by DAC 1 will change the VREF internal for both DACs. This means the unupdated DAC 2 will still have a reduced voltage output. It should be noted that the simplified architecture we show here is a worst-case example. Most modern DACs have reduced reference loading to improve gain error, linearity, and crosstalk by implementing reference buffers inside the design. The addition of a reference buffer reduces the effect of the series resistance between the reference input and the DAC ladder. This greatly improves DC channel-to-channel crosstalk, though it does add a source of AC crosstalk, as the changing load on the reference buffer could cause a glitch on the reference voltage for both DACs. This new source of crosstalk is remedied in some designs with the addition of a reference buffers dedicated to each channel. This strategy reduces both AC and DC crosstalk caused by reference loading, but at the cost of higher device complexity, so it is not implemented in all designs. Now let's discuss strategies to reduce channel-to-channel crosstalk. First, let's discuss good layout practices. In general, it is a bad idea to closely route analog signals that might have transients. A good strategy for laying out DAC traces is to fan them out and to separate them from each other and any other signals that may have fast transients. In addition, reducing lengths of traces and efficiently routing them can help. Next, power supply loading as a source of crosstalk can be reduced with good decoupling and layout techniques. Using wide and direct traces from the power supply source to the DAC supply pin will help reduce the series resistance and inductance on the trace. Placing decoupling capacitors as close to the pin as possible will isolate some of the series resistance from the supply node. This will help with AC crosstalk as the capacitor will reduce voltage changes on the supply pin during current transients. Finally, for devices that use external references, reference loading can be reduced through a few different techniques. For example, R-series can be reduced by ensuring that the trace from the reference is as short and direct as possible. For devices that do not have an internal reference buffer, an external reference buffer can be implemented that'll isolate the reference source from the load current of the resistor ladder. This will help with AC crosstalk if the amplifier is faster settling than the reference itself. This is a very effective way of improving AC and DC channel-to-channel crosstalk. Some devices that require very high precision will also feature reference force and sense inputs for this purpose. The reference force and sense pins are essentially two parallel inputs to the reference node of the R2R ladder. The expectation is that the force input will be the output of the op-amp that is acting as the reference buffer. The sense input is a signal that connects the inside of the DAC ladder to the reference node. This can be connected to the feedback input of the reference buffer. This means that all series resistance can be ignored as the voltage across the resistors is compensated for by the amplifier. This greatly reduces DC crosstalk. The only downside is that the op-amp selection is critical. Low offset voltage is needed if the DC accuracy of the reference is important, while high bandwidth and fast settling is required to reduce the AC crosstalk. Okay, so in summary, there are three primary sources of channel-to-channel crosstalk. The first is capacitive and inductive coupling between multiple DAC outputs in the PCB layout. The second is power supply loading, allowing a voltage drop in the supply pin of the device when one channel's load changes. And the last is series resistance from the reference source. This resistance reduces the reference voltage for all channels when the load on the reference changes. We can reduce channel-to-channel crosstalk by implementing the following strategies. First, we can ensure the layout properly distributes the DAC outputs geographically to reduce the coupling between the channels. Next, we can minimize series resistance in the supply input of the DAC by using short and direct paths from the supply source and by placing decoupling capacitors as close to the pin as possible. Finally, we can utilize reference buffers on the device that has an external reference input, and we can minimize series resistance on the reference input by using short and direct traces. In addition, we can use the force and sense pin on DACs if they are available. All right, now let's take a short quiz to check our knowledge of channel-to-channel glitch. Question 1. What are the main sources of channel-to-channel crosstalk? A. PCB layout parasitics. B. Power supply loading. C. Reference loading. Or D. Digital communication. Digital communication does not cause channel-to-channel crosstalk, but it may cause digital feed-through. All other answers are valid sources of channel-to-channel crosstalk. Question 2. Which DAC topology has better reference loading? And by better, we mean less contribution to crosstalk. Is it A, string DACs, or B, R2R DACs? The answer is A, string DACs. The primary reason why DAC topology can result in channel-to-channel crosstalk is that a resistive load on the reference changes. Recall that R2R DAC resistor ladders have a code-dependent total impedance from the perspective of the reference. String DACs have a constant load on the reference, regardless of the code. Question 3. Using the force and sense pins of a reference input will improve channel-to-channel crosstalk. True or false? The answer is A, true. Using the force and sense connection with an external op-amp as a reference buffer allows a series resistance inherent in the design to be ignored, as the buffer will compensate for any voltage drop. Question 4. True or false? Channel-to-channel crosstalk can be found on all DACs. The answer is B, false. This is a bit of a trick question. Channel-to-channel crosstalk is only a valid issue and specification on multi-channel DACs. Single-channel DACs cannot have channel-to-channel glitch by definition. It is still possible that you see some of the effects that we've discussed here, such as reference loading, on a single channel, but it is not crosstalk. That concludes this TI Precision Lab about channel-to-channel crosstalk in Precision DACs. Please find more Precision DAC technical resources and search products by visiting ti.com/pdac. Thanks!